Well, good morning, everyone from La Jolla. Good afternoon, depending upon where you are in Mexico or Houston or Washington, D.C. Welcome to another edition of our energy webinar series here at the Institute of the Americas. This is Jeremy Mace, President for Energy and Sustainability. And quickly want to thank our sponsor of this year's webinar series, Intercap Energy Systems. And today we are very pleased to have Marco Cota, the CEO of Talanza Energy, joining us, and I'll introduce him in a moment. But he will be speaking about something that every day seems to be a ever more important topic in Mexico, and that is understanding compliance risks in Mexico's energy sector. And for those of you who have not joined us before, just a quick note or two on the logistics mechanics of the webinar. And so I will make some brief remarks here at the outset, and then we will invite Marco to deliver the formal presentation of about 20, 30 minutes or so. And then at the end, we'll have a question and answer session via the platform here and via the website. And then for those who have not seen this before, we use the chat function. And so if you see on the bottom of your screen, there's a bar there where you can participate in the chat function for the webinar. And that is where we will receive questions from Marco and conduct the question and answer session. So you see I've written the word question. So no need to wait until he's done with his presentation. If you want, during the course of his remarks, please feel free to pose a question, and we'll come to those at the end. So we're, like I said, very happy to have Marco presenting today. And I think I could speak for several minutes about so much of what's going on in Mexico. But I do think it's important to highlight that what we look forward to hearing from Marco are some insights on how companies in Mexico that have won particularly oil and gas contracts during the reform process and the series of auctions that have been hosted in Mexico, how to understand the compliance elements associated with those contracts, and particularly with regards to CNH, but not only CNH, all of the other regulatory bodies associated with the opening in Mexico and the private participation of companies in the marketplace there. Obviously, we're in a moment of political transition in Mexico. There are a lot more questions than there are answers as to what will come next. And yesterday, or the night before yesterday, provided us another question as to what's going to happen next, specifically with the change over the resignation of the head of CNH, Juan Carlos Cepeda. Obviously, CNH and Juan Carlos have been principal architects of the energy reform and the private sector opening in the oil market in Mexico. So the transition in Mexico has presented a series let's call them questions. Obviously, in the more bigger picture, the airport decision is something that's been looked at by several of probably everyone who's participating in this webinar today and trying to extrapolate what that kind of process and referendum and management and policy overview of this incoming government. And it's still incoming. I think this is the thing for many of us that's so amazing as well, is this is not quite the government yet. I mean, we still are a couple of weeks away from this López Obrador administration actually formally being the government, which has made this even more complicated, the length of the transition and so many of these issues that are at play. But with that, let me pivot more to the specifics of what Marco's going to talk about. And Marco, by the way, is also somebody who has a deep background in the energy reform in Mexico. He worked for many years at SENER, and over the last 10 years at SENER was working directly in the hydrocarbon sector, and left SENER a few years ago with the title of Director General of Exploration and Extraction of Hydrocarbons in the Hydrocarbon Undersecretariat. And somebody who worked very closely with all the authorities there, Lourdes Melgar and Aldo Flores, on the development and SENER's participation in crafting and designing the implementation of Mexico's energy reform in the oil sector. So we're delighted to have him with us. More recently, he founded Covar Energy, but as of a couple of weeks ago, he is now the CEO of Talanza Energy, and I'll let him give a quick update. But just so you all understand, Talanza Energy is a company dedicated to the study and analysis of energy policies, and particularly regulatory compliance in Mexico. And as Marco will share with us, it is even more complex than I think so many of us begin to understand. Obviously, those of you from the companies on this webinar know firsthand just how complicated and the risks involved, and not just, there are literal financial risks and contract risks. So Compliance is critically important, and then we layer over all of that, all of these issues of broader geopolitical and political developments in Mexico, and I think we have what maybe in a technical term is one hell of a boiling stew that we're cooking up. So with that, I want to turn it over to Marco Cota, and Marco is an old friend, so I'm delighted to have him participating, I think, for the first time in our webinar series and presenting. So Marco, over to you, and we look forward to your presentation today. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much, Jeremy. Thank you, everybody, for your attention. Yes, I'm very honored to be here in this webinar. And joining Jeremy, this is very exciting moment and difficult also for the upcoming future of the implementation of the reform. So let's start with our presentation. Our presentation shows a little bit our expectation for the new government and the consequences of what we are expecting to the compliance of exploration and production contracts in the near future. So the first part of the presentation talks a little bit about why EMP activities are so critical from the compliance perspective. The first slide shows you that this is a couple of tables with statistics. And you can see at the bottom right of each of these tables that there are 259 procedures that regulated companies need to face when they develop their operations. So the first table shows you four any of the phases that they are foreseen in the contracts and the legal framework. This is the transition stage for startup, the exploration, appraisal, development, extraction, final transition stage, and this column on transversal procedures are they apply in any of the stages of the contract. So we can see in the last column, the one of the total procedures, that CNH and ASEA concentrates the big majority of the regulations, so all of these procedures that companies need to comply with. So you can see that 170, that it is the total of the transversal procedures, apply to any of these stages. Then the next table shows you that these 259, there are 215 that they are non-periodic. What does that mean? This means that they are not repeated activities or repeated interactions between the operators and the regulators. But the rest of them, that they are more than 40, they repeat in a monthly, quarterly, semi-annual, annual, biannual frequency. So these 259, they have 40 procedures that actually they repeat alongside. So in any of these or in each of the contracts, you can have more than 259 interactions between the regulated party and the regulator. Okay, this regulated party, of course, they are the operators and the contractors. So the next slide shows you the same information, but with other variables. So the first one at the left hand side, you can see that 136 of these procedures, they have a high cost. What does that mean? They are technical documents like the project plans, for instance, the exploration plan, the development plan, the system for HSC, that the activities, you know, that this is an important requirement of ASEA. These are requirements that they are costly in developing, and of course this gives you an extra complexity for the compliance. So 136, that it is more than half of the procedures are of high cost. And on the right hand side, you can see the days that take for the agencies to approve this permit. So there are important facts in these statistics. If we look at the average, we see that CNH takes on average more than 60 days for authorizing all of these 149 permits, and 42 the ASEA. The rest of them are there. Of course, I'm focusing in CNH and ASEA because they, as I already mentioned, they concentrate the majority of these procedures. So this second slide shows you that there is a lot of complexity and cost in the compliance. Okay, the next slide is an overview of all the complexity just for exploration phase procedures. Okay, so you can see here that there are a lot of procedures and requirements from the agencies just for the exploration phase. You know, in other countries, for instance, in the US, the exploration phase, it is regulated not as it is regulated just by a work program. Okay, you say I'm going to drill a certain number of wells, and that's it. I'm going to develop some studies. But here, the rules of the contracts, that if you want an extension, for instance, from the first period of the exploration contracts, you can have an additional an extension. Actually, normally for offshore, for instance, you have two possible extensions where you need to compromise more wells than the ones that you compromise when you participate in the bidding process. So there is, this slide shows you also complexity. So these three slides show you that compliance is a complex system for EMP activities in Mexico, and this has an important the reason is that activities in EMP remain as a strategic in the constitutional reform. It was the only stage of the whole oil and gas chain, value chain, that remained as a strategic. So the state actually is responsible of these activities, and if the state decides to sign contracts with private companies, they need to make a very close follow-up, and they need to authorize all of the plans and activities just on a daily basis. So in Mexico, the system, it is in a general way, it is governed by the state, mainly the CNH and the other regulators. I didn't mention it, but in the tables you could appreciate that there are more than 10 different authorities for for regulating an EMP contract. So the idea here is it is a complex system, and this, of course, it's going to be affected by a change in policy. Of our presentation, it includes some slides shows you how are we seeing the new government policy. So for starting with, we have the issue of the auditing, okay? The new government was very clear about the intention of auditing all of the contracts, okay? So here you can see a press release that unfortunately is in Spanish, but I will try to tell you that this press release talks about the intention of the new government, mainly the new Ministry of Energy, Mrs. Rosionale, to audit the case of Sama. Sama is this it is a well and a discovery of Talos company. It was actually the first contract awarded historically in the country. So we can see here in red that the new government was pointing out at some possible filtration of information, a leaking of information between Pemex and they assured that Pemex already knew about these reservoirs. There was corruption behind that. So this is actually a press release from September, but in the last days we saw again the press really active with the idea that that the new government is looking very close at this contract in particular. So what are some of the arguments behind the defense of this accusation? First is that how CNER did the block selection. CNER normally looked at a document that it is well known in Mexican government, is BDOE. We call it BDOE. The BDOE, it is a document where documented all the possible discoveries, but this document, it is built on just a very preliminary phase of the normal activities that you need to or that companies take to develop activities. So we can say that it is very preliminary, and this was actually the only source of information that the government used at that moment. So the numbers of the estimations of Pemex, they are showing in the screen for block 7. Of course, we were talking about 100 million of barrels of expectation for the discovery, but actually it resulted in 2,000 million barrels. So the difference is because, of course, as you can see in the timeline in the right bottom corner, the longest arrow in yellow is the time that companies took for evaluating the data rooms, okay? So there are several months, and actually the government took a couple of weeks for designing the block. So the information where the CNH departed to define these blocks was limited, very limited, and the time for the evaluation and the appraisal, of course, it was also limited, and this is the reason behind the difference between between the expectation of the government for this block and the actual result, the actual outcome of Talos when they review the information. On the left hand corner, at the bottom, you can see the biddings, the bids of the bidding process. So Statoil, Eni, Sierra, and of course Talos, that they were the winners, and Hunt, they offer quite similar proposals to the government. So you can see also that companies tend to find the same evidence, but not the government. So it was not, as the government is pointing out, that Talos had specific information in an illegal way, but it is more like a natural process of the bidding round, where not just Talos but other companies saw a lot of the potential in this block. The next slide shows you also, this is for July the 4th, that we were assuring to the international investors and international press that facing this probability that Andrés Manuel and the new government were going to cancel the contracts because of corruption, we were assuring that they were bulletproof, that this is not the only reason. These contracts and the whole system was designed on a crystal ball logic. And for those who look at the bidding process on the internet, it is very clear that there are no chance of any strategic behavior or corruption. So this was a main aspect for this former expectation, that they were bulletproof. The other aspect is that all of these contracts are, of course, they are backed up by international trade agreements. And there are a lot of investment involved with this contract. There is an estimate of the government that the amount of total investment behind these contracts could be of $160 billion. So this is very important investment for our country. This is mainly concentrated in offshore and mainly in deep water, that there are areas where Pemex has no capacity to work with. And at that moment, we were very, very confident that the contracts were not going to be canceled. After a couple of months, by September the 13th, the chief of the staff of López Obrador, he said that the model is quite successful, that they were not going to fight this model, that they were going to respect the contracts. Actually, the Minister of Energy, Rocío Nale, she moderated a lot her critics to the contracts, from where she started to this September the 13th was an important change in the moderation of his speech, and they assured that they were comfortable after they review almost all contracts. Okay. At the campaign, and in particular, these bidding rounds, we followed a crystal clear model, and of course there are a lot of international agreements that back up this kind of commitments of our country. So the next part is another aspect. So from the new government, we already see the auditing part. The next section, the next chapter, is we are talking about the turnover cost. This is actually mentioning that the first part, that it is the auditing, it is safe, it is on the safe side. We see that the turnover cost could be the worst part of the new policy for the new administration. Starting with the turnover cost, we want to, or this means the cost that we are going to face in the case that there are a lot of public servants that they are going to leave CNH, SENER, ASEA, and that's it. And the main aspect of the turnover cost is the DT policy. Okay, so in this talk you can see this is a table that this is not official, but it is more like a rumor that these are going to be the changes in salaries. This is the monthly salary according to the federal government structure. So this titular, this is the level of the commissioners, for instance. The commissioners of CNH, the level of the commissioners of CRE, and the level of the head of the ASEA. Okay, this is titular. So if you see at the two last columns, we can see that they are going to cut salary. The reduction in salary is going to represent something between 44% and 52%. So this is half the salary of the commissioners. And then you can see the rest of the administrative levels for the payroll of the government. So this DA, that it is the last level, the bottom level, to the titular levels, they are normally the levels that interact with companies. So what we are expecting is that there are going to be a lot of brainage. No sé, I don't know how is the word in English, but you know what I mean. There are going to be a lot of people running out from the government, and there are going to be people that they normally give attention to companies, okay, to the private sector. The next slide, of course, this changed a lot from yesterday because of this news of Jose Peda. But this table shows you how are the appointments of the commissioners of CNH. As you may know, CNH and CRE, they are regulated parties that they have some dependency, and the appointments for any of these commissioners are fixed by law. They last for 7 years. They cannot resign their position, or they cannot be fired unless there are important aspect of misbehave on them. But we can see that all of the commissioners, they have an expectation. For instance, Juan Carlos Cepeda, that it is the first one in the list, the expectation was that he was going to end in April 2019. He changed this because he already announced his that he's resigned from CNH. And Alma America, that is the second one, her expectation is up to March 23. Nestor Martinez, that it is the next one, is for October the 24th. And Hector Moreira is for March 20, 25, and Sergio Pimentel for September 28. Hector Acosta, it was supposed to have a renew on September the 21st. September of 2009, as well as Sergio Pimentel. But he actually announced several days ago, in August 23rd, he announced that he's going to resign also by November the 30th. So he's going to be in charge of Chihuahua's auditing agency, and Gaspar, that this is the last one, the newer one, this is his expectation for leaving office to 2029. These were like the appointments. If everything goes just as we expected at some point in time, but according to the austerity policy, they are going to have a cut down of 50% of their salaries. So it is very likely that some of them choose to leave office in the upcoming months. Juan Carlos Cepeda and Hector, they are anticipating the term of their appointments, but we are expecting to see others to leave office also. There is, of course, the policy also to decentralize the government, where Rocío Nale announced that she's going to operate in Villahermosa, Tabasco. So there are costs also for moving from Mexico City to Tabasco. So this is another barrier that we see that they are going to promote a lot, or incentivize a lot, the early termination of commissioners' appointments. So this is a very important part. We think that this is going to be maybe the hardest part for the change in the new government. And the last slide shows you also for the administrative level in a distribution by department of attention: the exploration, extraction, the contract administration, drilling permits, the national data center, the the surface exploration activities. We see 30, there are 30 people that they work in very critical areas for the administration of the contract. So, the new law that the Congress already passed about this austerity policy, this law says that nobody can earn more than the president, and the salary of the president is going to be fixed at 108,000 pesos. This is an approximately of $5,000 per month. So we believe that also, as in the commissioner's case, that a lot of critical employees are going to leave office in the upcoming months. So this part of the turnover cost, we want to point that this is the critical aspect of the change of administration. This can change everything as we know until now. Okay, so what if we put everything together? Okay, this is the current risk profile for compliance. And in this aspect, in this slide and the next one, I want to show you how things are changing. So We divide the sources of risk by government, operator, and legal risk. Government is also divided by type 1 and type 2. The type 1 is the normal aspects of government operation that can represent a risk. And the type 2, it is more linked to the change in administration. Okay, so you can see some of our main examples in the bottom part of the slide. So we have government risk type 1, like an adverse contract modification on turnover cost. Okay, there are normally there are people be hired in CNH, and they leave CNH, and this is a normal thing. When you have a new guy in office, of course there are a lot of confusion, and everything is new, and companies can suffer from this. And the adverse contract modification, that it is the 1A, you can see, I will explain a little bit more the risk matrix, but on the vertical side you have the consequences from these sources of risk to the compliance, okay? And in the bottom part you have the likelihood. This is the probability that we are estimating. So for 1A, the adverse modification of contracts, this already happened. This is a normal thing. There are new guy in office, and they are very excited about the new position, and they try to get everything better. They move something for the contract, and the most of the part, this is a good change, but there are also other situations where this can cause some contradictions between the contract and the regulations, and the turnover cost that we already mentioned. So 1A, it is a high consequence, could be a high consequence, but we see not very high likelihood. And the turnover cost, we see very likelihood, but a medium consequence. The government risk of type 2, this is the contract audits that we already mentioned. The ASEAS capture, this is the 2B, and CNH and CRE capture. With capture, we mean that the new government is going to put the majority of the commissioners from their political party, so they can use the regulators, as they are independent now. This independence is going to be lost. They would like to have control over regulators, and then to submit the technical regulation, the project regulation, to political goals. For instance, to increase production rapidly, sacrificing long-term production. Okay, so this happened a lot in the past with Pemex. The case of Cantarell, it is very well documented. There are a lot of people saying that Cantarell didn't follow with a good standard of development process. They didn't follow up the international practice, that they accelerate production. And as a consequence, we left a lot of barrels in the subsoil. So this is mainly this is now a very important aspect that we see from the changing government. The increase of compliance cost, national content, and the social impact assessment and the social investment plans could be used as also as a policy mechanism, but we, as they are already stated in contracts, we didn't find this with a lot of trouble. The operator risk, of course, these are the normally things to expect, like a misunderstanding of compliance, a deviation from regulations caused by public servants' recommendations. This, of course, is reinforced by the idea of having new public officials giving this guidance. And of course, this misalignment between the operator and the industry goals of advocacy. You can find that all of these in black, they are in the yellow red zone, they are in the border of the yellow red zone, and the legal risk. These legal risks are these contradictions between the legal framework and the contract, for instance, or contradictions between one agency to another. So the next slide shows you the new matrix, okay? The new matrix moves you almost everything to the red zone, okay? I want just to point out the regulator's capture. ASEA was, I think, in the same place because ASEA didn't have a robust institutional design as CNH or CRE. So they were always in the red zone. But we were expecting a couple of months ago that CNH and CRE were in the yellow zone, more like in the yellow-green zone, but now they are in the deep red. So this slide can show you how everything is moving to the red zone, and the causes they are mainly summarized to the regulator's capture and also the turnover cost because of the austerity policy. These are the main policies that we need to be afraid of the new government, okay? So you have these two risk matrix that summarizes how we are seeing the impact over the compliance of the contracts. The compliance performance, we have a series, as Talanza has a series of brochures. We call them one pagers. We normally put these in our social media, but we have two examples here. The first one is the well drilling and committed investment. So you can see that I'm going just to focus on the circles, but the round 1.1, the round 1.3, the 1.4, and the 2.1, they already have the exploration plans approved, okay? And they have a lot of wells committed that the companies are obliged to drill before the end of each exploration period. So at below the circles you can find a number of days. These days, sorry about it is not well displayed, but the round 1.1, you can see that there are blocks with 851 days that this time is the time from the approval of the exploration plan and actually the drilling. So because they are not drilled already, this accountability is from they were approved up to these days, okay? So you have that 851 days already passed for companies to get their wells drilled. The second circle is for 1.3, that it was an extraction. It is not exploration activities, but also you can see that there are some of them, they have 565 days. This is on average what they are lasting, what is the time between they have a plan already authorized and to date that they haven't drilled, and so on. Of course, the 2.1, that it is a closer or more recent, is a more recent bidding process, you have 27 days. This is normal time, but for the rest of them, it is a long time between the time they have everything to drill and they haven't done this. We find that this the main reason is that a lack of understanding of all of the compliance, because it is not just to have the exploration plan approved. They need to have a lot of permits from ASEA, from the Maritime Minister, the SEMAR, Secretaría de Marina, and a lot of agencies there. So there is complicity there also. And the next case is exploration plan approval. So at the top, you can see the main stages of the process, the submission, 35 business days for the declaration of sufficiency of information, the technical and economical opinion, and finally, the approval. This is 120 days, calendar days, plus 35 business days. This is an approximate of 160 days from the date that you submit your plan and you get the approval. Remember, the last case, maybe it was better to show this slide previously or firstly, because from approval is the accounting of the days for drilling that I already showed. But anyway, so this is the time that you are going to spend for getting an exploration plan approval. So what can we conclude from these statistics is that the country has 28 contracts for exploration, 29 plans were submitted already. From these 29, 15 are being authorized, but 14 are still pending. 13 have not been submitted. 36, the expectation is to have have this submitted by the fourth quarter of 2008, and one for the first quarter. Sorry, the number is not 78, it's 79 contracts for exploration. This is a typo there. But also in the right hand, you can see that for the first round, CNH authorized everything on time. For the 1.4, that it was the first of the water, approval took on average 47 days beyond the normal term. The 2.1, 4 of 10 were approved within 13 days of delay, and the rest are still pending. So there is there is a timing issue, and everything has been delayed in general terms from for the approval. And what we are seeing is that in the first timeline, these 35 business days, this is the time that CNH takes for declaring that your request is complete. And we know that this normally companies have been struggling with complying this on time. So this is the reason of the delay. And finally, the importance of compliance. Why is compliance so important? Because there are clauses, there are articles in the law that mandate the administrative rescission when there are delays in operations, when companies do not comply with the work commitment. We have seen that they are late already. And there are other causes. When there is one very important, if you submit or report information that has mistakes, that it is not perfect, perfectly report in two occasions, this is a reason for administrative rescissions. And of course, the consequence of not having an adequate compliance is the delay in permits and authorizations that we already saw, non-compliance of contractual obligations, and penalties, of course. So this is mainly my presentation. Sorry about taking more time that the one that Jeremy allowed. this is my conclusion is compliance is going to be a critical aspect for the new government. They have offered to cut down regulatory requirements, but I'm afraid that this requires a major re-engineering and overhaul of the whole institutional and administrative design of their reform. So this is not going to be just as an instruction. They need to design a new constitution, a new set of laws, a new set of regulations. Just to remind you, there was the constitutional change, more than 20 laws changed with the reform of 2013. And more than 20 bylaws were changed. So there's a lot of change to be done for changing the system. So I'm happy to hear your questions.
No, thank you. Thank you, Marco. Absolutely. And I mean, I think the fact of the matter is, you know, I let you go a few minutes over because there's just a few things to talk about. I think you went through a lot of important things, you know, and as I said at the outset, It continues, and thank you for a lot of your answers to some of the questions, but I think you posed some questions as well, and all of us involved in looking at Mexico and working in the energy sector are certainly a bit apprehensive and are trying to seek answers to questions, but unfortunately, I think there aren't quite the answers yet. But with that said, I do want to point out something that Salvador Beltran del Rio from Sierra Oil and Gas, which is the consortium member. You talked about the Zama project, and Sierra is with Talos in that project along with Premier Oil. And he wants to highlight that has gotten a lot of attention. There's been a lot of rhetoric, I would suggest, around the Zama project. And Salvador has said here that to look at the CNH governing board session from August 7th, 2017, to get some further insights as to some of the questions that are swirling about with regards to the Zama project and, like I said, what a lot of the rhetoric that we're hearing. So I just want to point that out. Thanks, Salvador, for joining us and making that point. There are a couple things. And by the way, folks, please feel free to jump in. You see the questions there, and just a reminder to use the chat function. There's a question here from Karen about the bill in the lower house, and you talked a lot about the latest developments. You talked a lot about the importance of CNH, and obviously you went through all the compliance elements related to CNH. But what's the latest on that bill that was proposed in the lower house that would put CRE and CNH under the control of SENER? And I think for a lot of us, very concerning, given the importance of autonomy and independence of regulators. What's the latest on that legislation?
Okay, thank you, Karen, and thank you, Salvador. Yes, for the part of the bill in the lower house, there is an important. It's an important. Conclusion there. I mean, you have two ways of achieving what Rocío Nale wants. Rocío Nale, it's clear that she wants to have complete control of the institutions of the oil and gas. So she's actually moving to Villahermosa because she's more aware of where they are the political basis of Morena, that this is going to be, of course, the sindicatos, the unions, that they are in Veracruz and Tabasco mainly. So what she wants to do, what we are expecting is that they can do things on the hard way or in a soft way. The hard way, of course, is to change the law and to give all the decisions to the Ministry of Energy. The soft way is what we already explained in the presentation. They are going to put pressure on commissioners. They are going to cut salaries. They are going to push all the commissioners to change their home, and this, of course, I will say, is more powerful than the hard way. So I don't believe that if we are facing the scenario where the commissioners are going just to resign because, you know, this is a very hard change in their salaries, or they are pushed to move to be, I think that this is more like a deal breaker than just having a new head there. So in a soft manner, Rocionale is going to have complete control of CNH and CRE because she's going to put there their friends and their political allies. Okay, this is very important aspect, because within Obrador's team, we can see that on the one hand, this is the Morena, and we can see this with the whole consultancy process of the airport. There is a Morena arm, but also there is the moderate arm, where we can see there the chief of staff, that is Romo, or the Minister of Finance. Remember that in Mexico, oil and gas activities are very important for public finance. So they are very important stakeholders for this case. So I'm afraid that we're going to see more the battle within the new government than the former government and the new one. I'm afraid that some of my friends in the CNH are going to leave office because they don't have any more conditions to remain working there.
No, I think you pointed out that obviously salaries moving. I mean, there's several points of that increase the uncomfort, the discomfort. And, you know, obviously with major policy changes, if you've spent several years working on a very specific direct policy objective, and now you have sort of a less clear vision. So let me ask you something. We're running out of time here, but there was one other thing I really wanted to ask you about, and that has to do with the contract review. And you talked a little bit about this, but here's something that I've had a hard time in, you know, I hope, you know, you can answer this to a certain degree. Who is managing, and when I say the contract review, I mean that this process that the incoming administration down has put forth in terms of reviewing the you know, the over 100 contracts that were signed by the government up until now. Who's managing that? But more importantly, what I don't understand is, what are the parameters for the review? I mean, what are sort of the guideposts that they're using in that quote unquote review process?
I'm not sure about how has been formally defined the process, and I will be very surprised if there are people reviewing the contracts. I think that they just have an overview of the model. CNH explained already and show the evidence, the how of the bidding process is designed. So it is a crystal clear process, and the contracts are public. They are available to the public, and in this sense is very clear to see that everything has been without any sign of corruption or discretionality. This is why we always believe that the contracts were bulletproof, because the whole process is very well taken care of. I mean, I'm not sure that they are auditing the contracts. I mean, everything is public available. The CNH has been done an amazing work. They published some months ago these white books that they are actually the files of all the contracts. You can see on the internet, you can see everything, the government take, the offers, the signatures of the responsibles of the contracts from the government and the private companies. Everything is publicly available. There is no way that they can show that something is wrong with the awarding process. That I think that this is the main point. They are not making an auditing if they are complying or not, because as I show in the last slides, it is clearly that companies are struggling with complying on time. This is not a major fault. It is not cause of rescission, but I think that they are just focusing in the awarding process. And the awarding process has been internationally recognized, and everything is publicly available. So I think this is how things are happening now.
No, if it's right, I mean, I think no. If it's only so, and that's the part I've been confused about. What are the parameters? And if it's simply on the awarding process, as you said, I mean, I've attended some of those rounds. They've been done to the utmost transparent level, international scrutiny. So, well, obviously, many of these questions are to be continued. But let me end with a yes or no question. I always like to do this with panels and presentations. So here you go, Marco. Here's a yes or no question to end our webinar. And thank you again for your time and insights. It's a pleasure. Thank you so much. Here's the yes or no question. Will the incoming administration, will the Lopez Obrador government be able to and hit their mid-sexennial target for oil production? Yes or no?
Sorry, I think I didn't hear the question. Sorry,
Jeremy. Oh, that's a good one. Yeah, no one's ever told me that before. No, my question is yes or no, will the Lopez Obrador government be able to increase oil production and hit that 3-year mid-sexennial target they've outlined?
No.
All right. Well, I guess that was an easier one than I thought. Thank you again, Marco Cota. Thanks, everyone, for joining us. Let me put here on the screen, we're going to have a short panel here in La Jolla at the Institute. Duncan Wood and myself are doing a conversation regarding the Lopez Obrador government, and we'll be talking, I'm sure, about some of these similar issues, particularly on the policy and political side. So if you are in La Jolla or can make it to La Jolla here at the Institute on the morning of November 29th, join us. And then we'll be doing some discussions in Washington, D.C. Obviously, the U.S.-Mexico-Canada agreement will be part of that on December 11th. And it's never too early to mark your calendar for the annual La Jolla conference, and we hope to see many of you here for that. So, Marco Cota, congratulations on the launch of Talanza, or the relaunch of your consultancy. Thank you for your insights. We will stay in touch, and we look forward to hearing more from you, especially after December 1st.
Yes, of course. Thank you very much, Jeremy, and thank you, everybody, for your attention.
Have a great day, everyone. Thank you.